appreciate you, good saint, all the good participation, and we thank the Lord for being with us tonight. You pray for us tonight just for a little while. I want to talk to you on the subject containing to do with prayer. We started this morning dealing with prayer and what prayer can do for us and what it did for Jabez. Amen. How that Jabez, through his prayer, becomes successful, even though he was named being sorrowful, meaning pain. Brother Eric, when he was born, he was never to expect him to reach the goal that he reached. Say amen.
Amen.
I'm honestly, folks, when you look at Jabez, he was never supposed to be mentioned in the Word of God. He was supposed to be someone that was born and forgotten.
Yeah.
He was supposed to be someone that was born and lived. But because he learned to pray, amen, his name got put in the book.
Yes, sir.
I know I'm going to go out of bounds a little bit, but because I learned to pray, my name's written in the book.
Yes,
amen. The Lamb's Book of Life. Amen. Now listen to me. This week, now we've got revival coming up. It's just a little over a month away. We've got some things coming up around the church that's happening. And all these things can be made possible through prayer.
Yeah.
Amen. Prayer can get the job done when we can't do anything. Prayer can do wonders. Amen. Hey, when you pray, God seems to hear our prayer. And the Bible says God resisteth the proud, but he giveth grace to the humble. Those that are humble and step down and pray to God, he'll bless them. Amen. Now tonight, continuing on the subject of prayer, somebody says, well, prayer doesn't work, amen, every time. I have not found a sign yet that prayer did not work.
That's
right. Amen. It might not have got you the answer that you wanted, but it got you the answer that was needed in your life.
Amen.
See, I don't want you to go home tonight on this and tell your loved ones and tell your friends that the preacher said, amen, that without whatever I pray for and I believe, I'm going to get it.
Yeah.
Amen. Yeah. You know, I've got some grandbabies. And I make a big mistake one time of telling them, y'all be good. Papa will get y'all whatever you want when we go to Walmart. That's a mistake. Amen. Because you know what I told them? I said, whatever it is. You know what I did? I took them to the dollar aisle. But that ain't what they wanted. Then I got a little granddaughter that look at you and say, Papa, she called me Paul. She said, Paul, that ain't what you said. You said, whatever I wanted. Whatever I wanted. Now, you know, when she looks at me in that way, I realize what I've done. I put my foot in my mouth. And tonight, I don't want to do that with you. I want you to know that when you pray on something, amen, and you ask God to intervene, God doesn't look at your wants, but he looks at your needs, and he says, I'm going to give them what they need. They might not even know what they need, but I'm going to give it to them because they've asked me for it. Amen?
Amen.
Now, there's so many folks go home because God doesn't answer their prayer in the time or the way that they think that he should.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hey, folks get upset when you don't jump.
Yeah.
Amen. Folks get very disrupt. I mean, tore up. Amen. When you don't, God doesn't do it at the right moment. Amen. But we won't get into that. But tonight, we want to continue our discussion and our preaching on what prayer can do. Amen. And you, right before we get to it, while you're there, I want you to look at 1 Samuel chapter number 1. I want to talk to you tonight about a woman named Hannah. Amen. Now, some of you might know who Hannah is. Hannah is a very, very special woman in the Bible because she's got some special circumstances in her life that she is facing that she is going to need some greater help on. Amen. Amen. How many? Don't raise your hand. But there's a lot of us tonight have circumstances in our life that we don't know how to handle or we don't know what to do with. And all we know to do is pray.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Now, I want us to go to the Lord in prayer. We'll get started. Amen. I've already been told that wrestle what?
SummerSlam.
That's Josh's thing. It starts at 7:30. And let me tell you how the devil works. Hey, on these wrestling events, they used to last 3 hours. You know, the church would be open. Now he stretched it out to 4 hours. Josh let me know tonight it's 4 hours long. But then I told Josh, amen, they save the best to the last. So if you can get the last hour, that's all you have to, right there. But can I tell you, wrestling fans, something? If you miss it tonight for the glory of God, just turn on the USA Network, and they'll give you a rerun of everything that happened Monday night.
That's right.
Amen. Yeah. Say amen, Josh. Amen. Amen. But we cut up a lot down here. We have a good time, and we love the Lord. Amen. But tonight, let's get our minds off of what we're going to do after church and what we're going to do tomorrow. Hey, listen to me. Let's just put our minds on the Lord. I want us tonight, when we leave, to understand there's hope for us.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. There's hope. The devil would have you believe that there is no hope in your life. Well, preacher, amen. Hey, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, as we come to you just one more time, we thank you, Lord, for this day and this opportunity to stand and help folks. Amen. Just talk about prayer. And Lord, that how that prayer can change a life, how that prayer can add to a life, and how that prayer can keep us from things that would hurt us. Amen. We love you today, and we just ask you, Lord, we know that we can't do nothing, but we ask you, Lord, just to take our mind and take our lips and speak through us tonight, God, and just talk to your people. And God, encourage them to pray. Encourage them, God, to call on you. When the devil says there is no use, God, I pray that, God, we will find it down in us to give you an opportunity, God, to do what you do best. And you do things that men say can't be done. You find a way to get it done. I love you tonight. I thank you for being my friend and things being as well as they are. And I ask you to go with us. Lead, guide, direct. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now, if you will, in 1 Samuel chapter number 1, let me get hooked up here. Amen. And you just pray. But the chapter number 1 right there of Samuel, we're going to be talking about 3 or 4 different individuals. Elkanah, amen. That would be Hannah's husband. Amen. Now listen to me, Elkanah, amen, has done something that I find very hard. And I don't know how he dealt with it, but he has took another wife. Amen. And she's there, and God has blessed her with children. Amen. And let's just turn to this reading, and we'll get right into it. Amen. God being our helper. I thought they had moved Samuel. There he went, right there. All right, in 1 Samuel right here. And listen to this, starting with the second verse. It says, and he had 2 wives, and the name of the one was Hannah, and the name of the other was Peninnah. And Peninnah had children, but Hannah had no children. And this man went up out of the city yearly to worship and to sacrifice unto the Lord of hosts in Shiloh. And the 2 sons, Eli and Phinehas, the priest of the Lord, were there. And when the time was that Elkanah offered to give Peninnah his wife and to all her sons and her daughters their portion, but unto Hannah he gave a worthy portion, for he loved Hannah, but the Lord had shut up her womb. And her adversary also provoked her to make her fret, because the Lord had shut up her womb. And as he did so year by year, when she went up to the house of the Lord, so she provoked her, therefore she wept and did not eat. Then said Elkanah, her husband, to her, Hannah, why weepest thou, and why eatest thou not, and why is thy heart grieved? Am I not better to thee than 10 sons? So Hannah rose up after they had eaten in Shiloh, and after they had drunk. Now Eli the priest sat up upon a seat by a post of the temple of the Lord. And he was she was in bitterness of her soul, and prayed unto the Lord, and wept sore. And she vowed a vow, and said, O Lord of hosts, if thou wilt indeed look on the affliction of thine handmaid, and remember me, and not forget thine handmaid, but will give unto thine handmaid a man-child, then I will give him unto the Lord all the days of his life, and there shall no razor come upon his head. And it came to pass, as she continued praying before the Lord, that Eli marked her mouth. Now Hannah, she spake in her heart only, her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore Eli thought she had been drunken. And Eli said unto her, how long wilt thou be drunken? Put away thy wine from thee. And Hannah answered and said, no, my Lord, I am a woman of sorrowful spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but have poured out my soul before the Lord. Amen. And listen to me tonight. I want to talk to you on the power of prayer. But before we get into the mix, before we get into the part about prayer, let's look at Hannah's life, if you will. Let's look at what has drove her to pray. Amen. Listen to me. Now, I believe Hannah is a church-going woman. Amen. I believe she's married to a church-going man. I believe Elkin, the Bible says that, I read and I studied that three times a year, every Israelite was required, every Israelite man was required to go to the temple and pay tribute. Amen. And you know what? We find that her husband was a man that believed in God. I believe he was a good man. Amen. I believe that he was a man that looked after his family. While you read that where he took care of his other wife and Hannah, how that he gave them their portion, how that he took care of them. So Hannah was well taken care of. Say amen. Amen. She was someone that had someone she could depend on. Amen. Listen to me. But Hannah was missing something in her life. She was missing something, but Jerry, her life wasn't complete. Just having a man, and just having a home, and just having a place to sleep. Hey, and I'm going to be honest, if you would give me a little room, I don't believe old Ella can live in a little bitty shack. Amen. I believe he was a man of well means. I believe that he was a person that had a lot to talk about. I believe that he had stuff that that the Lord had blessed him with, but all of this didn't make Hannah very happy. Amen. Hannah was still miserable on the inside. And I begin to think of how many folks we have that come to church that look so elegant, that look so good, that sit on the bench and they look like, man, I've got the world, I've got everything, but they're so miserable on the inside. Amen. Oh, Hannah began to, we begin to see her life revolve in this chapter right here. When we read this, if we could stop right there, we would have read of a woman that has a good home, a good husband. Amen. What else can you hope for? Amen. Hey, some of you wives that's got good husbands, say amen. Amen. Some of you men that's got good wives, amen, say amen. 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 They're good to have. But you know what? It takes God to make a home. I want you to notice that. Amen. Now, I don't know if anybody here will agree with me, but if me and Miss Petey are together by the grace of God. Amen. Hey, somebody says, Brother Gerald, I don't know how it is around. Nobody else is how. But in the 20-something years that we have been married, we have not just had some quarrels. We've had some fights. Amen. There's been some hard times. And I know that none of you, I know you and Miss Bonnie has never had a fight. Amen. I know that y'all, I know that folks don't do that. And it's something crazy that happens in my house. Amen. But I look and Caleb, amen, the only thing that's kept us together has been God in our life. Granted, I can look at you when Brother Carlton was alive. I've been knowing him all my life just about. And she'll be the first to tell you that it wasn't easy living with him all the time. Amen. But it was by the grace of God. Listen to me. Hannah's got something that I thought she would have been tickled about. But there's still something missing in Hannah's life. There's something missing in some folks' life tonight. You might have everything that it is. You might have all the wealth. You might have all the things that the world can offer. But you're still missing something in your life that you are not satisfied with who you are. Well, let's look a little bit. Let's dig a little bit. Let's get nosy, as some folks say. Let's get curious. Let's look into Hannah's life. And let's see what's made her feel the way that she feels. Because I read to you in the Bible where Hannah's a bitter woman. And y'all know what a bitter woman's like. Woo-wee. Amen. That's somebody you don't want to mess with. Amen. I'm being honest with you. Hey, when mama ain't right, the house ain't right. Amen. Hey, Zach don't know what daddy's talking about. When you go home and you throw your hat in first, and if it don't come flying back out the door, you can go on in. Amen. Amen. I'm being serious. Amen. Hey, but listen, old Hannah, let's look at her life. Let's look. Let's get curious tonight and find out what's wrong with this woman. Amen. That seems in our eyes to have everything that a person could want. Amen. And I did some studying and I went back and I looked. You know what? Back in the Old Testament time, Brother Jerry, to make a woman successful, to make her valuable, to make her feel like she has reached her potential, it was how many children that she was able to bear. Amen. and in old Hannah's eyes, she was worthless. Amen. She felt like she wouldn't. She was an embarrassment to her husband. Everywhere they went, and let me tell you something, the devil don't make it easy on you. Amen. Hey, listen to me. Hannah was getting bitter. Amen. Hannah was getting very uptight on the inside. Hey, there's a lot of folks today that have got bitter because things have not went their way, because things have not worked out the way that they thought that they ought to. But Hannah's still going to church. Praise God. And she's still going with her husband. Amen. And he loves her. Amen. And Brother Zach, hey, listen to me. And each child will get a worthy portion. Amen. But you know what her husband Elkin did? He went to her and he said, I know you haven't given me any children. He said, but I love you and I'm going to give you a portion that's worthy of who you are. I'm so glad when I read about that portion that was given to Hannah. I thought that when God looked down through the channels of time and he looked at my life and seen that I was unworthy, seen that I was an embarrassment, seen that I was somebody that brought ridicule upon his house. But he said, I'm going to give you a portion of mine. I'm going to give you the best that I've got. I'm going to give you the whole. Somebody listen to me. When I wasn't worth nothing, Jesus loved me. When I wasn't worth anything, Jesus left us splintered of hell, and he come down and he took up a cross and he carried it up Calvary's Hill. Because he said, I'm not going to do it for what you are today, but I'm going to do it for what you're going to do for me tomorrow. And we're realizing that Hannah feels like she has been an embarrassment to her house. And I began to do a little duty, a little study, a little work here, and I found out during Old Testament times, if I'm correct, Brother Eric, that Elkin, by the custom and the law, he could have divorced Hannah, amen, because she was barren, because she could not have children, amen. He could have got rid of her, but you know what he did? Instead of getting rid of her, he loved her that much more, amen. Oh, he made, I'm so glad that when we went before we even knew God, the Bible says we love him because he what? First loved us. Amen. So we see the pressure that is on Hannah. We see, how many know what it's like to live under pressure? Amen. How many knows what it's like to have to go home like old Hannah did every day? Go home, Brother Larry, and walk into a house and see a woman like old Pinnacai. Amen. And all her children. Amen. Let me tell you something, Brother Jason. If you don't think the devil won't work on you, I believe every day that old Hannah come home, that old woman, that woman would meet her at the door with all of her kids gathered around you. Look what God's done for me, amen. What she forgot, it was by the grace of God that she could have them kids, amen. But listen to me. I wasn't going to say this, but God's impressed me to say it. Then some of us church members ought to get together and realize we are what we are by the grace of God. Now, it ain't because we deserved it, amen. It ain't because we earned it, amen. It ain't because we've been so good, amen. But we got what we got. It's because God has been gracious to us. And because God has looked down on us and given it to us. The Bible said in Ephesians chapter 2, he said, it's not by works that any man should boast, but what we have is a gift of God. Amen. Now, Hannah is living there, and Hannah has got a good home. Amen. And Hannah's got good folks around her. Amen. And the devil's there. Amen. Hey, listen to me, Richard. You ought not call that other woman, amen, a devil. When it says that she provoked her, said her adversary. And when I hear adversary in the Bible, my first thing is to think that, listen to me, he talked about the devil. Amen. Because Peter said, my adversary, the devil, is like a roaring lion going to and fro, seeking those he may devour. So when I hear that word adversary, amen. Amen. When I see that, it makes me think, Miss Petey, that this woman is doing it. Hey, God, what'd you do to make God do you this way? You know what? Have you ever let folks get to you? Amen. Have you ever let folks? Hey, I can see Hannah each day as she walked in that a question might be asked. Hannah, what sin have you committed? What did you do? Where do we get this from? Folks won't do you that way. Well, we've got to tear out the book of Job, because Job had three friends that was sure that Job had done something wrong. That was sure that Job deserved what he got. And they were sure that Job was paying for some sin that he had committed. Amen.
Yeah.
Boy, I like folks that pass judgment, don't you?
Yeah.
Amen. They look at you and they say, hey, look at him. Look at this man. Amen. Hey, look at him. He deserves what he gets. Amen. You better be careful. The Bible says, judge ye not that you be not judged by your own condemnation. Amen. That you're not. Hey, I'm going to tell you what. And you know who the strict and the hardest judges are is the folks that sit in our church pew.
Yeah.
The folks that ought to know how good it is to be forgiven. The folks that ought to know how good it is to find grace. The folks that ought to know how gracious God is to forgive us when we would. Hey, listen to me. Amen. And still, sure, I can see old Pentecost. And she walked in young as up, and she was kind of just provoking old Hannah. Amen. You know what? She still has done. She should have been behind me and said, hey, listen, Hannah, I know God ain't let you have one, but I've been praying for you, and I've been hoping, and I've been asking God that he would touch you with a child. Amen. Instead of provoking folks, we ought to pray for folks.
Amen.
Amen.
You know what the Bible says? It says, for the strong to combat the infirmities of the weak. Amen. We're to take care of them. We're to help lift them up. We're to help carry them on. But we're looking at Hannah's life. We've got it under a microscope tonight. And we have found that even though she looks like she has got it, she is prosperous, and she is doing real good, there's something wrong. Now listen to me. There's no marks on the outside of Hannah. There's nothing physically wrong with Hannah. The Bible doesn't tell us that there is a problem with her. And we find out, amen, we find out that God has just shut her womb up, which means there's nothing wrong with her physically. God just ain't ready for her to have a child yet.
Amen.
Amen. You know the hardest thing in a Christian life is to learn to wait on God when you pray for something, to learn to wait till God is ready to act. I tell you, when I read this, I thought about John chapter number 11. I thought about the Mary and Martha, how that they were friends with Jesus, how that he had been to their house, how that he had sat and eaten with them, how that he had dined with them, how that Mary had washed his feet, how that Martha had been about, covered about many things, how that all these things was taking place. And all of a sudden, Brother Eric, they went sent word to Jesus, said that Jesus, our brother Lazarus, one that you love, amen, said he is sick. He said, and you know what they was expecting him to do? Bam, amen, jump up from there and come running where they was. Now somebody say, preacher, how do you know that? Because they were disappointed when Lazarus died, amen. They were disappointed and disgusted in the way that Jesus did. My Martha met him and said, Lord, said if you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died, amen. Now somebody said, she said that in a very soft and smooth voice. I believe she met the master at the door and looked at him and said, hey, Lord, if you'd have been here, bless God, my brother wouldn't have died. You could have done something about it. Anybody, you ever talked to God like that?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. We're not supposed to reveal things like that. We're not supposed to let me know that Christians have those thoughts. I'm going to tell you something. The preachers have them things.
Yeah.
Amen. Do you know there's times when I look up to God and say, do you really know what you're doing?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, Eric. I do.
You're not alone, brother.
I'm like a truthful person. You see what I did? You see, there's one more beside me that has looked up to God and says, why weren't you there when it happened, amen? Why weren't you there? Hey, listen, they had prayed, they had got word to him, the prayer had been heard, but Jesus still waited. He told the disciples, we've got to stay right here, amen? Listen to me. I believe every time that she has went to the temple, because it said that as time that she had done it before, that when she got through, that she got up and went and prayed and asked God, amen, asked God to move in her life. But Hannah is missing something, and it's not on the outside, okay? I've got to get this point, then we'll move on. Hannah is missing, and where she is missing at, she is dead on the inside. Say amen. Hannah is alive on the outside, but there's nothing living on the inside. Her womb, she's got nothing living. I'm so glad I used to be dead on the inside. Amen. I was alive out
outwardly, but I was dead inwardly. Inside, I was like dead man's bone. I didn't have no hope. I didn't have no future. I didn't have no sight. I didn't have no vision. I didn't know where to go, what to do. But all of a sudden, through prayer, I got in touch with somebody to give me hope that my life had changed, that my life had turned around, that I don't listen to you. Oh, I had people like on Pentecost that told me God ain't never going to do nothing with you. I had folks in my life that said you will never amount to anything. I had folks tell me if you're a preacher, there are dime a dozen. I had folks tell me you'll lay it down before the year's out. But God looked at me and he seen something that other folks did not see. Oh, listen to me. But it's dead on the inside. And there's nothing but good about living on the outside and being dead on the inside. Because that inwardly man is what goes home with you. That what lays down with you. That what gets up with you. Amen. That what makes you walk and talk the way that you do. Amen. Listen to me. Oh, Hannah just about give up hope. She had done got so frustrated. How do you know that she got frustrated? Because the Word of God says she done quit eating. Amen. She wouldn't talk to her husband. She done withdrawn from everybody else. She done got off in the room. Done got in a deep depression. Done give up on her life. Thought she was going to be an embarrassment for the rest of her life. Amen.
Man, that's right.
Oh, but hold on.
Yeah.
Hey, I don't know about y'all, amen. Y'all remember them suckers that used to have the bubble gum in the middle of that blow pop? Thank you, Lord. Amen. You know what I used to do? I'd bust it, amen. I wouldn't spend all day sucking on that thing just to get to that bubble gum. I'd find me a rock. I'd hit that thing and I'd bust it. That candy wasn't that good. I wanted that bubble gum. Amen. Hey, listen to me. That's the way I am about preaching. I wish I could just jump right ahead and tell you what's going to happen in a few minutes to Hannah. But God said, wait a minute. There's some things Hannah's going to have to go through. And there's some things Hannah's going to have to do in her life in order to get to where she wants to go. And as soon as Hannah learns who I am, and as soon as Hannah learns what I can do, and as soon as Hannah learns, it don't matter what nobody else thinks, as soon as Hannah realizes it's up to me for whether she's ever blessed or not, I don't care what the devil said, if God's for you, then nobody can be against you, amen.
Amen.
I'm gonna tell you, we get excited, but we listen to Hannah. She don't know what's gonna happen. We do. Hey, listen to me. But Hannah has kind of got into a deep depressed state. And you have to watch folks that get depressed. You know in jail that when folks get depressed, they put them on a suicide watch. They put them in a cell, don't they? Amen. And they send them there by themselves. And they keep watch on how you know that preacher. You'd be surprised what's happening. Amen. Now listen to me, you say, preacher, you haven't been depressed. I've been so depressed that if my mind was, if they was to take me and turn me into gas and put me in a Hanks motorcycle, I wouldn't be able to have enough to go halfway around BB. Amen. And you say, preacher, what are you getting at? Amen. I'm telling you, I know what it feels like to feel like dirt. I know what it feels like to feel like nothing. I know what it feels like to everybody says you are a failure. I know what it looks like. I know what it feels like to walk down through the aisle and folks look at you and say he could have been, but he didn't. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Now Hannah's in that state, boys. We've got to be real careful with her. Listen to me. Listen, I see her husband going to her. I believe he's trying everything. I believe he's a devoted man. Amen. He went to her and said, wait a minute, Hannah. Don't you know I love you? Don't you know it don't matter if you ever have children? I've been better to you. He said, don't you know what I could have done to you? Don't you know, amen, that I could have got rid of you, but I didn't because I love you. And I give you just as much as I give to anybody else. Hannah, I love you. Said that ain't enough. That ain't enough. That ain't enough. I'm empty. Pelican, it ain't you, sweetheart. But I'm fighting a war on the inside. I'm fighting the devil in here. The devil's wanting me to give up. He's wanting me to leave. He's wanting me to lay down. He's wanting me. You know, if you ain't never been to that point in your life, the devil can get you to the point that where he wants you. He'll even convince you, as he has other folk, that living is not worthwhile. Amen.
No
heaven.
Won't you look at her life now? Listen to me. Let's go back and let's look at it. Hannah is a woman that, listen to me, that she is barren. That means she has not reached her potential. That means she, if you don't reach your potential, you know what that means? You're a failure.
Amen.
Amen. She feels in her life that she has failed her husband, that she has failed her home. Amen. She feels incomplete. That's a good word, ain't it? Thank you, Lord. We got any incomplete folks in the house of God tonight where you don't feel like you're nothing? I felt more than incomplete more than one time in my life.
Amen.
Amen. Incomplete, not done. Amen. And then them little kids sing a song, "He's still working on me." Amen. Well, listen to me tonight. Hannah, listen to me say, she is embarrassed. She is embarrassed. Listen to me. Now she is embarrassed, and she is even. Has the devil ever brought up your past to you? Has the devil ever brought up where you have been? Has he ever brought it up to you? You know what he's doing? He's trying to make an embarrassment out of you. He's trying to make you think of where you at, not where you're going. There's a lot of folks in here can't go nowhere because they can't get their mind out of where they've been.
Amen.
They can't get your mind off of what has already happened. Not what's going to happen, but what's already happened. Amen. And do you know God can't do nothing for you till you get your mind? Paul said, "I know this one thing." He said, "Forgetting those things that are behind me." He said, "I'm forgetting the past. I'm going to press toward the mark." Amen. He said, "I'm going to leave the past behind. I'm no longer that tyrant. I'm no longer that devil. I'm no longer that person that uses God's name in vain. I'm no longer that person. I'm going to be a man that God can use." Amen. Amen. Hey, some of y'all tonight, if you would just pray that prayer, "God, help me let go of the past. Help me let go of the things that I did. Help me let go of that person that I used to be." Amen. Help me, God. Help me. Help me. The devil's riding me. Help me. What are you talking about? Oh, Hannah went home every night, got in her bed, and all of a sudden she could begin. Now, somebody said, "Preacher, you have no Bible for this." Well, let's just use some plain brain, okay? Go home. Hannah goes home, goes into her house, goes into her room. All of a sudden shuts the door. And she's finally, she's looking for some peace. All of a sudden she hears a baby cry. She hears that baby cry in the house, and all of a sudden the devil says, "That's what you ain't got." Huh? That's what you ain't got, Hannah. God don't love you because you ain't got. Hannah, God loves you, but you got to trust him enough to wait on him because he's got something special for you, Hannah. In a few days, you won't be ashamed, but you'll be proud. Those that wait upon the Lord, Isaiah chapter number 40, in that last verse, it says, "Those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength." Amen. They shall rise up with wings of eagle, and they shall run and not grow weary. Amen. Amen. Hannah, don't give up. But can you hear it? Amen. Can you hear it? Amen. That little baby, I believe the devil paints one every once in a while just so old Hannah would hear it. Amen. Just so she'd hear it and realize. And see, she's trying to forget. You know what she would do? She would go in her room, shut her door, get away from everybody, try to get herself away from the world, try to get herself away from nothing but her and her husband. The best times that she had was with him, and her was by herself. Amen. But each time that she would hear a kid cry, or each time she would see a kid, she would realize, I'm no good. I'm an embarrassment. How many times has the devil ever showed you your past and told you that you were embarrassed?
Yeah.
How many times has the devil ever brought your past up and said, "God can't do nothing for you. You're hopeless." See, the devil works on this outward thing, but I'm surprised that life starts on the inside.
Man,
now, I know.
baby doctor. Amen. And I'm not going about to get into that like I heard a preacher get into it one time. And he got his way out. But I am scared to death to touch that. Amen. Tonight. Amen. But what I want to tell you is, amen, I'm going to tell you everything that they are. Amen. Listen to me. Life starts on the inside. Amen.
Yeah.
It is conceived inside before it's ever let on the outside. Alright, I'll break it down for you. A woman conceives and she conceives a child. Amen. And that child is conceived on the inside. And it takes 9 months before it's ever let out on the outside. Amen. During that time, oh, somebody get a hold to this. Amen. There's too many of us trying to live on the outside and not worried about the inside. Amen. Amen. You know you can't see what's happening on the inside of you until you go to the doctor. I'll never forget when Squirt here was born. Amen. That's been a long time ago talking about Zach. Amen. We would go to the doctor. They'd lay Miss Petey down on the table. Amen. And I'm naive. Amen. And they'd take this thing and they'd pull her shirt up. They'd rub it on her belly. All of a sudden on that picture up there, they'd come a baby. Somebody say, what are you talking about? I seen Zach before he was ever born. They like,
that's right.
He was just a wiggling and kicking. Amen. That woman said, that's your baby, amen. That's your, that was a promise that God was giving me. She said, here it comes. It hadn't got here yet. You got to wait on it. He'll be here in a few more months.
Yeah, man.
Some of y'all's blessings have already been conceived. Some of them are already been. What you need to do, what you need to know, what you need to do is through the eye of the Spirit of God, let that God show and give you a glimpse of what's happening in your life. Amen. Listen, I'd only been told what was happening on the inside of Miss Petey. Amen. I'd only been told. I couldn't even imagine what was fixing to happen. Amen. But when I went to the doctor and she did know what she did, I became a believer because God let me see the miracle that was fixing to begin to me. Amen. Touch this. Amen. I went home that night for the first time in my long time. My heart just shut up, preacher. I was so excited. I went home. We announced to everybody that Peter was going to have a baby. Amen. But when I seen that, what you call it? That's one I don't know. Amen. But when it happened, amen, Brother Eric, I went home and got on the phone that night after I seen him. And I told him, I'm going to have a baby. Amen. I'm going to have a baby. Amen. Hey, you know, I seen it. Amen. Amen. I got excited. They saw God need to open your eyes and see the blessing that God's got waiting on you. It's already in place. He's just waiting on the right time for it to be. I like to go somewhere. I can see Mama's eyes getting big now. I can see. Oh, I'm making off of that. Amen. But I'm going to tell you something. Amen. That night I become a believer. I got to see what the devil didn't want me to see. Because see, y'all don't know about this about me and Miss Peggy. When we got married, amen, she was supposed to be able to have children. She wasn't ever supposed to be able. We wasn't ever supposed to have none. Amen. We wasn't even supposed to. She went to the doctor and said, is there anything I can do to help myself to have a child? And they said, no. Miss Green said, you're not going to be able to have none. I like it. When she went back that next time, she said, I ain't feeling real good. Amen. She said, something's happened to me. I said, I don't know if it's just my living with Frankie or what. Amen. But something is wrong in my life. And that doctor told her, said, there ain't nothing wrong with you. You just going to have a baby. Amen. Well, let me tell you what. Somebody said, preacher, get you the message. Hannah is, she's hurting. She's hurting. She is very disrupted. Her life is in an uproar. She has, all she's been told is things that she can't have. All that she's been told is how that her life is never going to be like everybody else's. How that she will never know the feeling of having being loved. Some of y'all mamas, I ain't never know what it was like. I've held nobody over there. But they say there's nothing like what a mama feels when it's after she's gone through what she's gone through and they lay that baby in her arm. They say, now, I've never been there, but they say that she forgets the pain that she had just went through. They say she forgets the horror of the night that she had before. And she looks up on him and says, it's worth it. Amen. He's mine. I'm going to take him home. Oh, somebody ought to look at Jesus and say, I know I'm going through a lot. I know I'm suffering right now. Oh, but what I can feel when I hold you. Amen. It's worth it just to take you home today. Amen. Amen. All right, Frank. I'm a little strange. Amen. Well, listen to you. Ain't it good? Ain't it? It's amazing. Hannah is depressed. She's bitter. She is wanting to avoid other people. Listen to me. And even when she goes home, you read in the scripture with me how the devil don't just provoke her out of the world, but he goes home with her. Ain't it bad when the devil goes home with her?
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. The devil ever come to y'all's house?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Amen. Like the devil sometimes lives at my house at times.
Yeah.
You can let him off all you want to. Amen. And I'm not talking about my family either. I'm talking about literally an evil spirit hangs around my house.
Yeah.
Where things tear up. Where things that work perfectly tear up. Somebody says you're imagining that. No, when the devil moves in, he's out to kill, to steal, and to destroy. And he's out to make my life a nightmare. He wants me to go through hell. He wants me to give up on God. Amen. I've had things like light bulbs blow. You buy water, light bulbs at Walmart. Amen. Brand new light bulb. Put them in there and you turn the switch the first time and they blow. Amen. The half commodes get stocked up for no reason whatsoever. Amen. You have somebody get a hold of this. You have the water quit. Amen. Somebody, yeah. You ought to recognize who that is. The Bible says only good gifts come down from the Father above. Amen. But the devil invades our life. He goes home with us sometimes and he tries to tear our house down. Amen. And you can't pick the devil. It would be easy if you could bodily. Amen. See, I could get some of my friends. If you could bodily pick the devil up and throw him out of your house.
Amen.
Wouldn't that be good, Brother Jerry?
Yes, sir.
Well, we just bust out that Colt 44. Or we get that 357. Or we get that Glock. Amen. We pull it out. We plop it right at one time. And he'd be gone. Amen. But it don't work that way. Amen. Oh, we're going to get to the way that you get rid of the devil in a minute, boys. Amen. 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 Miss Petey, I'm telling you, God is wanting folks to go back to using what works. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to tell you what, oh, heaven is very disrupted. Amen. You know what? Our kids don't know what to do when things don't go their way anymore.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I've never lived in a generation to where people fall apart as fast as they do today.
Yes.
Hey, I'm serious. People fall apart at a drop of a hat. They think the worst automatically.
Yes.
Amen. They don't give God a chance. I mean, listen to me. The devil can say boo and they're already in the grave.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Y'all ain't going to come back here and preach no more. Listen to me. I love them. They ain't antagonists. Don't you be. Amen. Listen to me. I fell in love with Clint when he first come down here and he loved the Waffle House. Amen. You know what? I'll never live in Pittsburgh. There are no Waffle Houses in Pittsburgh. Amen. I won't go up there. Y'all ain't got nothing for me. Y'all might have the Steelers, but without a Waffle House, I'm sorry. There's one, there's hope. Amen. Amen. But Hannah is disrupted. Her life is being tore up. And by all rights, when she goes home, she can't find no peace there. There's nothing alive on the inside of her. She feels dead. She can't feel anything. Have I ever got any Christians in the house that ever felt like you were dead on the inside? Like nothing, you couldn't feel anything? That like God had withdrawn his spirit from you and left you barren. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
So, what about that? Now you get the picture of where Hannah's at. And see, we had to get to where Hannah's at to get to where we want to go.
Man.
And what made it so bad, I want to get to this point. Amen. She had a devil with her at home. And what made it so even worse, she had a priest that didn't even understand her.
That's right.
Amen. Amen. Now Eli done lost his grip a little bit. Amen. It won't be long before Eli is known for letting the light go out in the house of God.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Amen. Am I right, Brother Jerry? He is the prophet that is known for that the light had went out in the house of God, which means they wouldn't put no oil in the lamp. Amen. And times had got bad. Eli didn't understand what Hannah was going through. And listen, I said that to say this. The preacher might not understand what you're going through, but God knows exactly where you're at.
Amen.
I might not know how you feel and what you need to hear, but God knows your situation. He knows what you're after. He knows the very intents of your heart and your mind. Amen. That's what makes it so good. Amen. I ain't got to depend on God, man. I ain't got to go see an Eli to get in touch with God.
Amen.
See, she had to go through Eli. I'm so glad by what Jesus done that the veil was rent from the top to the bottom. And now I've got a personal life from here to glory. Amen. What is that? That is prayer. Amen.
Yeah.
Talking about prayer. If you feel dead on the inside, God is waiting on you to come to the point in your life to where you pray instead of fuss. Instead of you pray instead of complain. Where you pray instead of give up. Where you pray and let Him be real. Because see, Hannah had been, I believe, I couldn't find out how long she has been this way, but we know that it has been a time that ever since her and Elkanah has been married, they have had this problem. Amen. And she has been going to the temple, and she's been going to the temple, and each time I believe she's done been going over to where Eli was, talking to Eli, Eli, you know of anything that I can do? And you know, Eli, help me, help me, help me, anyway. But Eli had done got out of tune with God. Amen. I would say that, yeah, I would. Amen. You know, Brother Eric, I believe the time we have got a lot of men that stand behind our pulpits that have got out of tune with God, and they don't know what's really happening in our folks' lives. Because if they did, they wouldn't let things go on that's going on. Amen. Hey, I'm going to tell you something. Me and Miss Peggy went home this evening, and I didn't know that I was going to say anything about this. But I don't know how many of you like old John Hagee. Amen. Amen. But he preached a message today that I wish my church could hear. Amen. He preached on why America won't be able to stand by the year 2017. Amen. And you should have heard the facts and the figures that this man brought to the table. And he used scripture to back him up. And I'm going to tell you what. Out in Texas, where his church is, I see folks get up out of their seat and applaud the Word of God for being the truth. Our world is starving for the truth, amen. And we need men that will get behind the pulpit that has enough backbone and stand there and preach it with His power and His glory and His strength, amen. I would say, if I ever get my hands on it, I'm going to study that joke, buddy. That man had it. Now, get me, Miss Peggy. It got surreal in our little room at the house. Amen. We got surreal, and me and her was glued to the television. And I couldn't wait for his next point to understand why America was in the shape that it was in. Amen. I can't touch it. If you ever get to see it, y'all will leave it turned up. But you know what most of us will do when it comes to messages like that? We'll flip that thing. We'll turn it. We'll take that remote and go from hearing the Word of God to Andy Griffith, because the Word of God will cut us like a two-edged sword, but Andy Griffith will make us feel good.
That's right.
Yep.
That's right.
Amen. Hey, and that's what's happened. And I worry about it more than anybody else. I get in my car every day, and I got in the car with Miss Petey this morning, and I got in and I said, Mama, I get so worried and tore up that I'm going to upset somebody, and they going to leave, or they going to go away and do something, or go out to the rock. I just get real tore up, and it felt like Jesus just opened up heaven and looked at me and told me, he said, won't you just quit worrying about it? Just preach what I give you. Be instant in season, out of season. Be long-suffering. Be a friend. But be a friend they can depend on to get the truth. Tell them when they ain't You know what he told me? Miss Petey's got to say it. And this is what I felt. God didn't literally speak this to me, but it just felt like Miss Petey said, "Suck it up, buttercup." Just suck it up, buttercup. I could feel it. She didn't say it, but I could feel her looking at me. What's wrong, buttercup? Buttercup. We got a lot of buttercups today. But Brother Josh, I get so worried about people's feelings and about how they're going to look. I want to be loved. I know you can't tell it sometimes, but I love to be loved. I want folks to like me. But God said, preach the word. Amen. 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 And you know what? I worry so much how I'm going to deliver it that I miss my message sometimes. I say, is it going to offend Marsha? Or is it going to offend Brenda? Is she going to jump up and body slam? Amen. Or is it going to offend somebody? Amen. Is it going to offend Brother Tony or Brother Donnie? Or is it going to offend somebody? Amen. You don't think that goes through a preacher's mind? He wrestles with that each and every Sunday that he takes to stand. But God told me from here on, I don't want you to worry about it. I didn't call you to win a popularity contest. I called you to preach my word. I knew that you was a man that could do the job, or I never would have touched you with it. Amen. Somebody said we're running the crowd off. Well, when we get the crowd gone, those that are left will rejoice and we will praise the Lord and we'll have a good time in the house of God.
Amen.
Amen. Adam, as every she is misunderstood by the priest. She is thought to be a drunken person. But what Hannah has done, instead of run, she has decided to pray. Oh, power in prayer.
Amen.
We've got too many Christians running today. Amen. Instead of praying.
Yes.
Hannah had every right. She had every reason to go home. She had God had not let her in on the plan. Ain't that? I have told God this more than once. God, if you would just give me a glimpse of what's going to happen, I could do this a whole lot better.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. God, if you just let me know, I'm going to get a better job in 6 months. I'm going to make more money. This is going to build my bank account back up. I won't have a hard time going through this low spot that I'm going through.
Yeah.
But God said, I'm not going to let you know, because if you can see it, why should you hope for it?
Right.
Paul said, things that we can see, we don't have to hope. We know. Amen. But faith is the substance of things hoped for. It said it is the evidence of things not seen. Amen. That is one of God. I can see it. Amen. I'm going to tell you what's wrong with Eli. He ain't seen folks in church get like that in a long time. She never forgot herself. Y'all ever prayed before and just got beside yourself?
Yeah.
I mean, now listen, it ain't happened to me many times. But granted, there's been times in my Christian life where I've got down and prayed and I've literally got a broken heart and a contrite spirit, and God has let me step aside and me pray. Brother Eric, he not even know what I'm praying about. Amen. You ever felt like that? That's a wonderful feeling. Oh, Hannah, sit down and listen to me. There's nothing coming out right here, but it's all coming from right here. When it stops coming from here and coming from right here, we can get God's attention.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Hey, the Bible says this. You say you love me with your lips. He said, but your hearts are far from me. Amen. You know what? When we get to where we talk to God from the heart, let me tell you how. Can I take just a few minutes and tell you how we talk to God? When things go bad, we won't come down here and talk to God like a businessman. We won't come down here and say, God, I messed up. I know. Amen. I know. But you know what? We can't. You know the problem we're having in churches today is getting folks godly sorrow of what they have done.
Amen.
Everybody wants, they get a big case of feel bad.
Yeah.
They get a little feel bad. I feel bad about what I've done.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah. And they'll come down here in this office and they'll say, oh my God, I'm sorry. Just forgive me. Amen. Help me a little bit. And when they get up, they do not come. Godly sorrow means that you hate what you have done. That you are so tore up about what you have done that you don't never want to do it again. Amen.
Amen.
Has decided not to walk away from the house of God. She says, I know that I am buried. And she says, I know that I am an embarrassment to God.
and my husband and my house. She said, and I know that the devil goes home with me every day. And the devil just sticks and probes and sticks me every day about things that are happening in my life and telling me that God don't love me, that God is doing me wrong. Oh, if we could just, if Hannah would have had just the end of the first chapter, she could have had a glimpse of just the first chapter of what was going to happen to her in her life when she decided to pray instead of run. But see, Christians that run wind up praying. And if you don't believe it, you go home, there's four chapters of the book of Jonah. I want you to read. He started off running, but he ended up praying. He ended up praying. Amen. Listen to me. We find Hannah at the altar. Hannah has got beside herself. She has forgot all the reasons that she has been told that she cannot have kids. And she has went to God. And she says, God, if you would just bless me with a man child. Now listen to me. You know what old Jabez said? Bless me indeed. It would have been good for her just to have a girl child. But boy, for a woman to have a man child, that's a real blessing. Amen?
Amen.
Hello?
Yeah.
Hello? She's not asking for God just to do a little miracle. She said, God, I'm trusting in you to do something big in my life. Amen? She said, give me a man child, one that can come out and work for you. Amen? Get a hold of it. Hey, we got to stop just asking God for the little things. We've got to turn our life over to Him. Amen? We've got to say, here it is, God. Do with it as you please. Work with us. Show us what you have us to do. And then give us the wisdom to do it. Amen? I've looked at Solomon. I have not studied Solomon out like a lot of preachers have. But he asked God for wisdom. I heard one old preacher said he ought to ask him for some common sense to use it. Amen. That's what the old preacher said. He said, God, Solomon knew everything to do. He knew what to do. He just didn't have enough common sense to do it.
Amen.
I had to take that home and chew on that a while. But then, I looked and the things that got Solomon in trouble were the things that God told him not to do. So the old preacher must have known what he was talking about. Said it wasn't nothing hard. God had pinpointed not what to do. But Solomon just didn't have enough common sense to do it. Amen. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to wrap this up real fast. Hannah says, God, I know it's got to come from you. She's praying. She said, but if you'll just give me a man child. Just give me a man child. So everybody know that I am in your favor. That you are blessing me. Because see, he could have just given her a little girl. Like in the Old Testament time, a man child was so much more prosperous. Why was he more prosperous? Because he could work for the area. He could earn money. He could help the family. He could protect them. He could say, amen. Yo, is it that late? We ain't missed that much brass to that. Amen. Amen. Listen to me. But what I want to tell you is this right here. God heard her prayer.
Amen.
This is, I won't go right here now. That would be all she had to say. But then she said, God, that would have been it. And I believe God would have answered that prayer. She said, God, I'll tell you what I'll do. We get in trouble when we tell God what we will do.
Yeah.
Amen. God, if you knew this, I'll do. God didn't ask her. God was going to bless her. God had plans for Hannah. Amen.
Yeah.
This baby was in the making. Long before Hannah ever got to where she was at the altar. But people get in trouble when they tell God what they will do. Amen. Amen. Hannah said, I tell you what, I want one so bad, God. You let me have him. When I lean him, I'll bring him back and give him to you. Ooh-wee. That might not have been there, but I read and studied a little bit about 3 years after he was born. He was weaned, Brother Eric, by Corrick. She had to bring him back to the temple and turn him over to Eli, a man that didn't even know what she was doing when she was praying.
Yeah.
Right.
Huh?
there's a message in there, but we can't get to it. We got to go home. She gave it to Eli. Eli didn't know what his job was, but God was waiting on him at the temple.
Yeah,
amen. Y'all remember the story when old Samuel went to bed, he heard a voice.
Yep.
Three times he heard that voice. Woo! God knows he's coming. Amen. He said, I've been waiting on you, boy. He said, Eli didn't even know what was happening to him. Three times old Samuel went to Eli. Eli finally perceived that it was God calling the child. He said, you just answer him, boy, when he calls and say, your servant waiteth. Amen. We get in trouble when we promise God. Tell God, if you do this, I'll do that. You know, we get in more trouble about what we promise, not what God asked us to do,
yes,
but what we promised to do.
Yes,
on our own.
Yes,
my dad used to tell folks, leave praying alone. He don't need no help getting in trouble. Amen. Leave him alone. He can do that all by himself. And he was right. Yes. I had a way of finding it. I blamed it on that trouble. I blamed it. It waited on me wherever I was. Amen. But listen to me. I want you to know she made a vow, but she kept it. And God blessed her. Now, oh, I'm going to be an ugly Baptist tonight. Through her prayer, God has blessed her. She went home and they opened the rocking chair in the front porch and opened that guy. Got to talking about her young'uns, about what they done. Old Hannah Barrett back says, you got one at the temple? You got one going to be a judge over Israel? Oh, look out now, preacher. I'm devilish tonight, ain't I? Amen. Like to rub it in the devil's nose, and God heard my prayer, and he heard me when I called, and he answered, brother. Girl, and I just want the devil to know that he can. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I just like to tell the devil every once in a while. You said we couldn't have them. We got them. Amen. Amen. Any of y'all's kids ever been sick? Amen. The devil said they're going to die. That ain't it good every once in a while? We rock and say, they still here.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Somebody ought to get happy. Amen. On just the prayers that God has already answered. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I'll never forget. Amen. Miss Peggy got, I'm playing good song. I got to jump off of it. Miss Peggy got cancer. My wife. My wife. That's my wife, man. I'm preaching. I'm preaching, I'm going to church, I'm doing what I'm supposed to. I'm praying, God, you deliver her. Don't let nothing happen to her. She goes in for a biopsy, and I'm thinking in that beach and that chair, ain't nothing going to happen. Everything's going to be glory. God's going to show up, show out, and they come back, tell me my wife's got cancer. I say, God, there's something wrong with this picture right here. Amen. I didn't show it in front of her. I had prayed for God to take care of her, and I had prayed before that that God would keep us together. Amen. And do you know what cancer did for our home? It did not separate us, but it made a bond between us. Amen. That's thicker than anything I've ever seen. Amen. Boy, I'm going to tell you what. I realized what God was doing, and I quit praying, God, don't do this, God, do that. I said, God, you just let your will be done in her life. And, but God, if you will spare her and let me keep her, I'll preach for you. I want to do more than I've ever done before. Amen. Amen. Now, every time, used to, I don't know how many years, 5, 6, 7, 8 years after she had it, we'd have to go see this doctor in Snailville. They'd check her blood, and they'd check her everything all over. And every time I'd go in the office, the old devil would say, they're fixing to come out and tell you that it's reoccurred. Amen? They're fixing to come out and tell you that it's back. The devil's, granny, he is constantly probing me. Amen? Trying to get up under my skin to get me to quit praying. Each time the old doctor, I'd be sitting in that room. He'd come back and say, granny, it looks good for another year. Amen? I'd leave, and I'd get to the door. It's still gone. Amen? Somebody ought to tell the devil, I still got it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Once in a while, just tell it, I still got it. Amen. I failed. We had this discussion not too long ago about this eternal security. Amen. I'm going to tell you, them folks is worried about their salvation. Amen. They ought to pray till they pray through. And once they realize they got it, they ought to hold on to it, because Ephesians 4 chapter, 4 chapter says, I am sealed until the day of redemption. Now somebody tell me if I'm sealed. Unless I'm not, nothing's going to happen to my salvation, because it's locked in. Amen.
Amen.
I know. Anna, you got a son now. But Princess, she don't get to go see him. Oh, yes, she does. See, because old Samuel was at the temple. And all three times a year, it's required. Oh, Ella can. It's so happy. Says, come on, Mama, let's go see our boy. Let's go see our boy. Let's go see what he's doing. Let's go see what God's doing in his life. They, some of you could enjoy your kids better if you just turn them over to the Lord.
Yeah, right.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Listen to me. I'm going to tell you this. Amen. Listen to me. I want you to realize something. Amen. Hey, Zach, you're not a kid anymore. You're 22 years old. Bless God, you're a man of your own. You're as strong as daddy. You're as big as daddy. And you can do what you want to. Amen. I can't stop you. But I'm going to tell you what. I'm not going to give an account for what you do. Amen. You're going to stand in front of God and give an account, whether they're good or bad, for the things that's done in your body. And it's about time that our kids learn that mama and daddy ain't going to answer for them no more. That they're going to have to be accountable for what they do. It's quiet in here, though. I just want people to know you got a check, you got the cash. You know, kids don't understand that nowadays. We ain't raising men and women. I get in trouble saying this. Amen. We raising buttercups. We've heard our kids, Brother God. They didn't have to work. They don't work like we did. We've heard our kids. We give them everything they've asked for. We thought that would be a good mom and dad. We thought that would be, preacher, get off of me. No, God wants you to know where you stand. And he wants you to know you're not going to blame anybody else for what you do. You are a person of age. Amen. And I'm going to tell you what, you ain't got to be 21 years old. I believe when a person comes to the age of accountability, that Brother Eric, he starts giving account to God for what he does. You're going to back that up to age accountability when you come to know right and wrong. You know you need God. Abbott said, I'm going to pray. I'm not going to run. I'm not going to anybody else. I'm not going to see anybody else. I'm going to the man that can do something in my life. I'm taking my life to God and let him, no matter what, have my life. Oh, Eli said, she's drunk. She don't know what she's doing. And I got the hush. But when Eli said that, you know what? That's the type of shadow of the world looking at us when we pray and we talk to God, and they look at us like we're a bunch of food. They look at us like there's no use for you to get down there and pray and agonize with God, because there is no God. Can I tell you what the Bible says about that? The Bible says the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Amen. Now tonight, we have analyzed a little woman whose life looked good on the outside, but she was tore up on the inside. Guess what? Nobody knew that but her. She looked good from the outside. Why, she had a good home, a good God-fearing home. Amen. Amen. Let me see. Oh, Chris Grimsby, that's the preacher you were telling me about. Preacher from Greater Heights. He said that when he was growing up, said he was a preacher that said his daddy was a pastor and he was the pastor's son. Said he did everything that was expected of a pastor's son. Brother Glenn said he told him that when he grew up and he got a job that he no longer had to live under his daddy's roof, that he started doing what he wanted to. Said he would make $100,000 a year and blow every penny of it. said he got his life into the shade. The word money, he couldn't do anything else for him. And he said, I wished I could go home, but he was too proud to call home and ask his daddy if he could come home. Let me show you how God works. Lynn said, Mr. Grimstead, the preacher said, he got a phone call one day, and it was his daddy, saying, son, come home. I need you to help me. God was opening the door where he could come home and he could start doing what he was supposed to be doing. Amen. You know what? God was being merciful to him.
Yes.
And today, if you ever hear him preach, God has got an anointing on his life because he knows what it's like to be someone that acts the part, but is not really who he acts like.
Amen.
And then he knows what it's like to be real. And I pray and still running. Won't you stop running? Won't you start praying? Won't you let God be real in your life? Why don't you trust God? Say this, Mississippi, there was no miraculous touch that we can read of in the Bible. God didn't send it down and it fall on her at the altar, Brother Eric. Though Eli told her, said, you go on home now and God grants you that which you have requested. That's what Eli told her. He said, God lets you have what you have. And Eli was supposed to be the voice of God. And he said, and God lets you have. You know what she did? She got up, she cleaned her mouth, she cleaned her face. Amen. She might have had slobber on the side of her face because she done got tore up. And she went home. And she was in a better mood. She had a better outlook. She, you know what she knew? You know what she knew? That she had got in touch with God. That God had heard her prayer. She felt like God was fixing to move in her life. Could have been 10 years, could have been a few years, but I don't believe it took long. That's when the Bible says that when she got home, the other guy knew his wife. And before long, we talked about Samuel. That's a great God, ain't it?
Yes.
That's the kind of God I want to pray to. Tonight we're talking about the power of your prayer. Church, we need to start praying for our revival. We need to start praying for the members of our church. They are being attacked by the devil.
Yes.
Yes. Amen. The devil kept a whole family out of church today with a sinkhole.
Yes, sir.
Amen. They put members of our church being kept out with backaches and with headaches and with trouble and strife. You know what we can be doing? Praying that God make the devil release you. Well, how do you know that ain't God? Because God ain't going to keep folks out of his house.
Amen.
Won't you wake up and smell the coffee? Stand with me. How many have ever been like, don't raise your hand. How many have ever been like Hannah? And just felt like your life is not adding up to what you thought it should be. And you're thinking about giving up. You're depressed. You're down and out. Thing about giving up. Instead of walking off and running, why don't you turn around and pray? Go ahead and sing.
Thank you.
old verse and we'll go. Hannah could have went home. Can we not agree? With everything that was stacked against her, she could have went home bitter, cold, and disrupted, and not even talk to God. The world had her pinned down. The world has not done her right, Brother Eric. The world has missed her. The world has just robbed her. The world has mistreated her. And she could have blamed it on the world. She could have blamed it on the way she was treated, or the way that she was talked to, or the way that things happened in her life. Let me tell you what. Let me tell you what Job said. Man that is born a woman is but a few days and full of trouble. Get a grasp on that. You stay on this earth long enough and you'll go through trouble. And it's nothing that you've done that caused it, amen, but it's because of the sin that was committed in the garden that trouble has fell on each and every one of us. And I want you to know something today. You go home bitter, depressed, and tore up. Just take it home with you and have a horrible week. Or you can get out some of that pride that you got and walk down this altar and ask God to help you in your life. Pray and ask God. God, I know that I don't deserve it, but God, I'm asking you, God, for an opportunity to turn things around. Amen. 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 But it's up to you how you want to go home. It's up to you how you want to go home. It's up to you how you want to face the end of the morning. Amen. I'll never forget. I used to get up on Monday mornings and I used to hate to go to work. I used to hate it, Little Larry. Go to work. That's all I ever did. Go to work. Go to work. We had a kind of depression. Work got slack up here and I couldn't find a job nowhere. I found myself on my knees saying, God, I wish I had a little work. God, I got bills coming up. I got bills coming up. I got bills that's due. Mama's worried about how we're going to pay the light bill. Mama's worried how we're going to take care of the young. Mama's worried about what's going on. I said, God, if I wished I just had a little word. If you would send me some, God, that show would be help. God got us through it. Now, I get up. Yeah, it's hard to get up. Every morning when I get to work, we have a prayer before we get started. I said, Lord, I thank you for the work that we had. Because I remember the time that when I prayed to you, that I didn't have nothing. I remember the time that where I prayed to you that I didn't even have the money to pay my light bill. I don't know if folks ever got in that shape before, but you're looking at a preacher that didn't even have enough gas to get to work the next day. He had to call the man that he worked for to get enough money to put in the tank to get to work to make a little money. I tell him, I said, God, I thank you that things are well as they are now. I thank you, Lord. And I ain't complaining. Just give me the wisdom and the strength to do what I need to do today. So what you going to do? How you going to go home? You going to go home defeated? Or you going to go home let God lift this up off of you? It's up to you. Hannah could have went home and listened to old Penica again. Listen to her fuss and brag and listen to her ridicule her. She said, I'm tired of listening to that devil. She said, I'm going to talk to God about it. God said, it's going to be all right. How about it tonight? Wouldn't you like to pray? Wouldn't you like to talk to God and get things worked out? They, some of us, troubles at Trinity, has got loved ones, it's got folks that we need to pray for. Amen. Amen. Oh, Josh, up there. Where y'all come from, Granny, at the church, I can't think of the name of it. But Josh used to sing, Oh, Two Shoe. That little old woman used to pray every Sunday for her husband to come to church. She'd pray. And old Josh would sing that song, and he'd get to that part. That one morning, she looked down. There come Two Shoe. Walking down the aisle. Get worked, prayer worked. Prayer worked, prayer, get the job done. Save me one more verse, but it's up to you. You gonna pray or you gonna run tonight?
I'm out.
Appreciate that. You can be seated. Hey, appreciate everybody being here tonight. I hope folks have done what God has asked them to do. I hope you have followed the leadership of the Lord. I hope that you start your week off on the right foot, being prayed up with God, being prayed. I can't think of a better way to start a week than that right there. Amen. With God on my side. Amen. We love you tonight.
Thank you.
Boxes of blessings. We do have a few of those left. If you didn't get one the other
Sunday morning or Sunday night. That's where we're taking up mission boxes. They'll be going out west to different communities. There's a couple of Indian reservations they're getting on there. And just a quick reminder, fill the box up, leave about a half inch at the top so that they can put their traps in it. Don't take the top, take the bottom good, put the two rubber bands around it.
Amen. Remember that, if you'd like to help some.
At the end of September, the last Sunday of September, we'd like to have them back so we can get them shipped out there to us.
All right. Nothing else to be said. Just stand to your feet, turn around, shake hands with one another, and everybody have a blessed week.